Freemason scientist is like a complete contradiction in terms. I've charted these scientists' repressed sexual, religious, and sexual curiosity towards the bisexual rights movement, because they don't want to accept it's a legitimate movement. And now Master Bowie has passed. I keep watching how at times we think of a pact, a willingness to have some sort of implicit pact so we can dwell amongst the faithful. But inevitably the faithful want to recruit you. They put you through the same terrors you spent years clawing your way out of. It might be time to call Christianity on its bluff in such a profound way that it's every protagonist will have to contend with our arguments. And what will they have to say? Except to run away.
Offering 2 free years of our Christian college guide, which is 8 issues in all, nearly a
there is
free. It has lots of practical advice about choosing, paying for, and adapting to college life, and insights about today's leading Christian colleges.
Something that I call the 2 virtual U's that that I think you get from when you are compelled to involve or subscribe yourself in involvement with the Christian church. And it's a sorry price to pay indeed for the, so that proselytizers can, and zealots can, try and give justification to their theologies, about the Christ as a savior. But it involves this virtual you that, is what comes out of things like being born again and being cleansed from original sin, the original sin that Eve wrought upon the species by eating an apple. You do have to believe in those sort of things first, or else that original sin won't really seem like a realistic idea to you. So both of them are like, both these virtual yous I see to be so much more could be achieved in one's philosophical life. There's such a better, so much more better ways one can put one's time to use. So, actually, and the other one, the you that is the save, that gets saved, like, and you were on this such and such a path, but you were saved from, etc., etc. That's the, you know, that's a version of you that's supposed to give, again, give justification to, and the need for a savior, and I don't think, I mean, I think in my life, certain things you just realize on the course of maturity, or as you get a thirst for knowledge. I certainly don't credit religion with according me any sort of unique, victorious moral insight or awareness. It was definitely confusing because it was confusing because I couldn't find anyone else who knew how or why God was the source of good that he was constantly being called, and that would make him out to be the worthy of the sort of admiration that God is shown through church worship practices and all the songs that are sung each week to the Christian God. In fact, verses in like books like Isaiah says, "I create evil and I bring woe. I, the Lord, do all these things." So in the book of Isaiah, God directly takes credit for all kinds of evils. So that fact is right there until believers are prepared to discredit the Bible as they teach it. They're then forced to address that their deity is actually taking credit for all manners of evils, being the cause of all manners of evils, and even causing them with intent. In past centuries, believers and apologists have had to insist that something about this or that a person negatively affected by evils, that's such a state of affairs resulted in their lives because they had to have deserved it, and that the evil had a punitive quality or corrective or judicial quality to it, in at least insofar as God was concerned. So I can also recall finding that to be an offensive notion in church in my teens as well. Only I was extending it to the crucifixion. I didn't understand that theology, yeah, that you know, he died for you. I think, yeah, it's very offensive. It is more offensive than what Satanists, even theistic Satanists, have to say. So to roll back and not be so tangential, I'll readdress the elements of Nietzsche's writings, which I would highly recommend what was by fans referred to as the fifth gospel, with some humor. And that was a book of his called Thus Spoke Zarathustra. It's a powerful parable-like fiction book about willpower, and this man, Zarathustra, who creates sort of a discipleship of his own and pronounces to a believer that God is dead. And that's the famous statement of Nietzsche's, God is dead. He took this challenge on board in his day. about whereby he was a psychologist and an antichrist, but he seems to have a different understanding of what being an antichrist means than Marilyn does. Marilyn sort of built on it, you know, with his sayings like God is dead now, you're your own God. And some people I've known in the police through my former job went on to call me things like invincible because of my interpretation of Manson's interpretation of Nietzsche. And I think that was offensive because they would say things like, well, you know, you make up all your own rules. I said, no, that's not true. I followed all of yours, and, you know, my greeting from this Capital Chemist group involved two senior citizens of staff relative to me as a newcomer. They stood and addressed me and were kind of pointing their hips towards each other while looking at me, and one of them went, hmm. And the other one had her hand out, like, in front of her forehead like this, and looked at me like this, and said, video. Then in later conversations, I realized she was sign languaging me to think about thoughts of my own dick by that greeting, which later worked out was more than a violation of the Privacy Act. It was, and she would say to me, you know, I've seen your future. And she kind of convoluted a lot of my thinking, dreaming, and spirituality, which to me is really only art. I've already written about how I consider art, philosophy, to be an art form in a sense, because a lot of philosophers I admire are either oppositions to the Christian right, or former Christians themselves became oppositions to the Christian right. I'm offended by the term repressed Christian, which I've also been called, because that implies things like, you know, they think I'm in denial about a true inner Christian self, which is just not the case. And I've debated this with too many people over and over again. I consider to have comprehensively falsified all the major claims of theistic Christianity. I'll debate this with whoever wants to. It's a shame that apologists don't want to do that directly through, you know, email exchanges or meeting me on a forum. But I think in Nietzsche's case, you know, we know he went mad late in life. There are documentaries on Nietzsche that you can watch, and there's one called Genius of the Modern World, Friedrich Nietzsche. It addresses how Hitler and the Nazi regime took a lot of his ideas about willpower, and his concept, the Übermensch, sometimes described in English as the Superman, but the German word is Übermensch, and it means overman. And it goes back to an expression in Thus Spoke Zarathustra, where he says, man is something to be overcome. What have you done to overcome him? Behold, I teach you the Übermensch. It's got nothing to do with Superman or heroism or Superman comics, or especially, it certainly has nothing to do with anti-Semitic warfare and Hitler's dictatorship and the gassing of Jews. In fact, Nietzsche himself was opposed to anti-Semitism, so there's one really key point that justifies, you know, the claim that many people make, that many Nietzsche admirers make, that Robert Solomon and people in philosophy's The Teaching Company address, which is the claim that Nietzsche's ideas were taken and misconstrued by German military, and by their means, Jesus was retrospectively defined as a martyr. Now, it's impossible to call him a martyr just by going from the Gospel of Mark. But if Nietzsche in his day was not aware of the gospel datings that we know of now, then I can appreciate Nietzsche's confusion to some extent. I like in principle the idea of the Antichrist for reasons I've already given, namely being opposed to the murder of Jesus. And it's very hard not to be if you isolate the Gospel of Mark and consider that the other three Gospels are what we would today call, after the fact, hearsay plagiarisms of the key ideas espoused in Mark's Gospel. It doesn't seem he was a man embarking on any grandiose ideological cause. In fact, he was, you know, intercepted by the King's Guard and didn't comprehend his accusatory question as a question. He felt it was a statement, so that tells me he was more or less sensitive to the way authorities would speak. But you know, I can recall looking back at TUC, the church I went to as a teen, and this youth pastor Gary Bradford, who is now a Muslim. One speech I think Gary Bradford would owe to former members of TUC is a metaphysical lecture on why he switched from the Judeo-Christian religion to Islam, and where his integrity is in that. I don't know if this is in his book or not. I'd like a copy of his book because I'd love to criticize it. I know he hurt a lot of people who were my peers in the church days. There was a gay friend of mine who had died recently, who was a very talented keyboard player, and this man, Gary Bradford, once took him to the car park and said to him, despite being more talented on keyboards than anyone else in the church, Gary had said to him that unless he was to cease being homosexual, he would be banned from using his key musical skills on the keyboard at the church. And I just thought that question was really unfair. Same youth pastor was trying to call me gay at times. And he would call attention to a passage of the Old Testament where God is said to have said that the sins of the father will be punished and passed down unto four generations, which implied, from those who were affirming that verse, that I'm not to reproduce, essentially. For four generations, my bloodlines are apparently cursed by this god. And, you know, neither of these leaders had any comprehension of either of my parents' motives, blood parents' motives, or of the fact that the case between them from 1989 had been closed in the federal government. Nor did they ask me what my understanding of my blood father, who is now dead, of what constituted his motives. I remember my nan would sit me down and read me these Cluedo novels in primary school, and I used to get every case right. She would she'd read the mini mysteries to me on her armchair. This is a fag armchair from Capital Chemist for DJing for them at a conference, but I prefer it on the floor. But yeah, I left quite depressed because there really was only there was one girl in my church who I suppose was confused and hurt by a lot of what religious people were saying to her. And she also loved the disabusing power of my two favorite artists. She and I more listened to Korn when we dated when I was in 10th grade. We listened to a lot of Korn together and we loved it. And she knew my life's goal and dream was to become an artist myself. And she was very supportive of that and would say, I know that you'll get there one day. And to this day, I will never forget her. Just as I'll never forget Natalie Ovchinnik, my high school friend who first lent me Korn and Marilyn Manson CDs. I haven't been able to tell her yet that I sort of got to meet him at a concert, but and she seems now to be more into the thrashier and more aggressive death metal, but that's her business. But Nietzsche's written books like The Gay Science, which was about happiness, finding happiness. It was written at a time when gay meant happy. It didn't mean it didn't mean getting ass fucked by a guy. Nietzsche took responsibility literally and as a philosopher for his statement that God is dead, because he understood that the ramifications of that proclamation meant that for the people, all their notions of morality were all intertwined and invested in their God belief. So he didn't want social anarchy or a collapse of society's comprehension of moral truth and virtue just because he had declared that God is dead. So he wrote that it was the time for what he called the transvaluation of all values. And he wrote a book called The Genealogy of Morals, Beyond Good and Evil, Twilight of the Idols, Ecce Homo. But yeah, I got a bit sad when in this documentary I learned that he fell in love with a woman, and it seems he loved her very dearly. I think his mother was opposed to him marrying her, but he proposed to her and she said no. And I've wondered why the courtship didn't work, why she turned him down. And it's kind of left me with my own pet theory, because some philosophers truly do devote their whole life to philosophy to the extent that their romantic character suffers for the works that they try to make for their society. And to be true to yourself as you absorb and comprehend multitudes of perspectives from numerous thinkers. I personally think of it as an error to take what fragmentary, contradictory, and confusing, and well after the fact, and therefore hearsay constituting evidence of literary evidence of who Jesus of Nazareth was and what he stood for. It's completely inappropriate to call him a martyr, as Nietzsche does in The Antichrist. Although when you read the passages where he's quoting Jesus and rebuking a lot of his teachings and calling him a martyr, most of those teachings and quotes that he picks are from the later gospels, which you know, we now know that those who wrote Luke's and Matthew's gospel already had a copy of Mark's gospel. So, yeah, it's interesting because Marilyn's work is, he seems more attentive to the nuances of where other philosophers, even mid or during Enlightenment or post Cartesian logic, post Enlightenment existentialist philosophy goes. And I think this should address, you know, the charge of being called a repressed Christian, because there's no desire in me to want a theistic God to exist. I've researched both negative and positive atheism, and as a gesture to believers, I just tend to, as a default, hold on to my negative atheism. And I don't mean negative and positive here in the sense of moods. It's got nothing to do with moods. It's got to do with metaphysics. Negative atheism is just simply saying no case yet has been made to convince me that a God exists, so I lack theism. I am atheism, like without. The prefix a means without the following word. So atypical means without type, asymmetrical means without symmetry, asexual means without sexuality, like as with asexual plant reproduction. Atheism means without theism. It doesn't mean repressed theism. It's like it's as stupid as saying, you know, that just because you can remember what it's like to grow up as a kid, that they therefore you're a repressed child. You know, it's to me the concept of telling an atheist they're a repressed Christian, it's some sort of like attempt to convolute and confuse and mischaracterize the progress that they've chosen to make as adults who have studied non-religious and atheistic language and concepts. So I didn't intend to falsify psychiatry or psychological assertions in being an atheist. I've also studied positive atheism, and positive atheism is about you advancing in debate with a theist and bringing forth your arguments as to why God doesn't exist. And Michael Martin probably has, and George Smith probably have, are the two authors with the best books on this, these two types of, or two aspects to atheism. But my manners in this regard is that, you know, if I'm confronted by a believer saying, can I talk to you? I'm interested in converting you to my religion. As I live near a Mormon church, I've had, to an extent, some conversations with some of their representatives. And they're absolutely invited to, but in general, my debates have been restricted to forums where I've been invited to by religious people to, as a non-religious person, to get into debates with these religious people. So, you know, this narcissistic employer in 2009, she'd intimidated me years beforehand at a conference where she took one look at me and just said, oh, Homer Simpson. And I was going, what the? Like, I haven't told anyone in your company that I like The Simpsons. Why do you look at me and call me Homer Simpson? This was in about 2000 and maybe 2002, Lake Krakenback is a location that the Capital Chemist Group were partial to taking all the staff for their conferences. But yeah, I think in being true to yourself, you have to make sure, it's true with being progressive as well. Like you try to boil down what you were taught to its most valuable or most meritable ideas. just so that you're not a person who has left a church in a state of confusion. Like, in fact, you've read or you've spent $1,000 on books, you've taught yourself a lot of things, you've debated a lot of people, and it's my manners that I'll wait until I find a forum where they say, yeah, you can debate us here, we're looking to convert more people into Christians, but you're welcome as an unbeliever to debate us. That's why I got peeved when these Capital Campus people not only violated my privacy once again by drawing attention to a pseudonym. Like, when you go on a forum, it's not about profiling, because yes, the forum will say profile name here, but you type in a pseudonym, so you know if the Privacy Act is true and going online at your computer desk is a private act, and you go onto a community forum, granted the records of my debates and discussions may be held on that forum, but and I don't mind about that, because I'm aware that that's a public forum. My Facebook account's private and it's for my friends, and that's not because I have anything to hide. But yeah, because I don't like the attitude of preachers, I would wait until a person came to me, talked to me about where they were at philosophically, and asked me what my ideas were. And I repented and rebuked the title of a leader, which was something I was called in ninth grade by the church. I was the youngest in the ministry to be offered a leadership position. It was about in ninth grade. At the time, I was a bit touched to be offered the position, but because I too was trying to understand the case of Jesus, and I hated a lot of the worship music, the Hillsong lyrics, and the, you know, I think South Park in series 7, where they form a Christian rock band, they really do sum up with wit and humor the pathetic sort of singing babble that goes on in churches in worship of Jesus Christ, the Savior. I see it the other way around, you know, if anything, we would want to save him from the crucifixion. That's part of my understanding of being an Antichrist. Because I'm absolutely against taking young people from their families. You know, the lectures of Gary Bradford saying your parents are wrong, they've taught you wrong, which I was open to consider because, you know, I'm open-minded. But my question at that point in his preachings are, like, would you be willing to invite the parents of all these kids to sit here at your, you know, you only have a Sunday night youth group gathering, and you're dissing everyone's parents, and you have no kids of your own. It's very much like Roger Tall. Are you prepared to say the sort of things you'll say to young people in private, in a public setting, and be open to cross-examination and scrutiny and cynicism and rebuttals from the parents of these young people? And I tried to, after leaving, spend time thinking about why. Like, after the youth pastor moved to Camden Church, I learned through the grapevine that a teenage male had become suicidal as a result of this man Gary's preachings, and spent a lot of time thinking about why that happened. And I honestly think it has a lot to do with pushing the doctrine onto kids that Jesus Christ is their Lord and Savior. And that's for a number of reasons. I mean, it's got something to do with God belief in the first place. Second, it's got something to do with the condensing and merging together of all four Gospels, because yeah, we've just got the King's Guard suiciding Jesus to carry his cross up a hill, you know. If Jesus lived as a servant to people, and the King's Guard were king and queen were fascinated by him, or other or wanted him dead because they felt he was a threat to the throne. That's what's implied by them asking him the question, "Are you the king of the Jews?" It's like, in what? Why did he even start to appear to be some sort of contestant to the king and the queen, who says nothing in the Bible? And that's where I wonder if he was a bisexual male, because bisexuals tend to get along with people of all sexual orientations, men and women. And so the ancient monarchy obviously had a heterosexual only sort of political dictatorship then, and no word for a bisexual male. So you know, Jesus's murder being unjust is what we are left with from Mark's gospel, and then it's redefined by Matthew as if it were a man who was ministering, that he completed his mission by being crucified. It says nothing about this false accusation, "Are you the king of the Jews?" causing him confusion and putting him into a whatever mind state. It strikes me in Mark that he's kind of going, "No, what the? What do you mean? Why ask me this question? I'm not the king of the Jews. I hang around with the poor, the sick. You know, like, how does that make me warrant being asked if I'm the king of the Jews?" So I sense him being just so intimidated by that question, because it wasn't what he was into. I see progress relating to the scrutiny of monarchism in the late David Bowie, Master Bowie's conviction to decline an offer for a knighthood from the British monarch. And I think I know why, because in many respects, he was at the forefront of the bisexual rights movement. I think he might have thought, well, if I receive a knighthood from the monarch, who are still saying that, you know, Christianity and the Bible contain imperishable truths, then if he shook hands with the Queen and got his knighthood, he would essentially be saying, yeah, I want honors from this biphobic political structure. What's that, and what message will that send to the bisexual community, who he obviously has always stood up for their rights in all of his art, and for unity in all of his art? So it was completely appropriate, to my mind, for him to decline an offer for a knighthood. If the Queen burnt the Bible and apologized to the people for trying to promote Jesus' murder as something that saves us, I think that's sending a really bad message to young people these days, because it's telling them essentially, you're a murder in the Bronze Age, the blood is on you, he died for you. In Mark, he was murdered, and we're told it's for us. In Matthew and Luke, it's more like he has more superpowers. He's performing more miracles, and he's saying things like, "Forgive them, Father, for they know not what they do. Into thy hands I commit thy spirit." And the narrative is spun into, like, it's as if he knew he was meant to be crucified. Like, he knew, and he's more of a willing human sacrifice. Then in John, it's all about God sending Jesus to earth to complete a sort of mission for God. And we've got that horrible verse, John 3:16. But if you put that all together and you consider the date gaps, you know, 70 AD, 80 to 85 AD, and then 95 AD, you've got to wonder what went on between the scribes and who the scribes were answering to as these later gospels were written. Because if you reverse the evolution, well, it's
evolution is the wrong word. If you reverse the subsequent gospels and their content, and you question why are they putting new words in Jesus' mouth now in these later gospels? Why are they saying that he stood for all these things and was so idealistic? And I just have these sort of little cartoonish nightmares of where I ask myself, well, what if the scribes were affiliated to the King and Queen's Guard and they originally sensed that Jesus' murder was unjust? So they're going, what the fuck do we make out of this man's character and story, and how do we tell it to people? And, you know, representatives of the King's and Queen's Guard are saying, oh, look, just say he walked on water, just say he gave his life willingly. Don't say he was suicidal, and don't say he was coerced, and don't say he was driven to the point of suicide. But that's all what's implied in Mark, because there's no follow-up series of questions. So why, Jesus, do you think you're the King of the Jews? Who told you were the King of the Jews? By what right do you claim to be the King of the Jews? How did you become the King of the Jews? Why do you want to be the King of the Jews? None of these questions are even asked. It just seemed that they overwhelmed him with the charge and then made him carry his own cross up a hill. Now, yeah, if he'd been serving everybody, if I was serving everybody and then asked to carry my own cross up a hill just to get nailed to it, then the only word for that frame of mind that I would be in while carrying my cross up a hill is goddamn suicidal as fuck. I don't see him as being ashamed of having anything to be ashamed of. I forget which book it's in where we're told he stole a donkey, but I don't think he's going to go, well, I stole a donkey, shit. I better carry my own cross up a hill and get nailed to it. And that's why I admire the interview between Marilyn and Bill O'Reilly, which I've posted on Facebook and which you can find on YouTube, where, you know, Manson is charged with his art causing violence or violent motives. And he responds by saying, anyone can look at Christ on a cross and say, this is an image of murder, this is violent, this has sexual imagery. And it puts Bill O'Reilly into check, because he doesn't contest that. But the question of in what way does the crucifixion contain sexual imagery, that's a horrible and morbid question, because it basically draws us to ask ourselves why, when he was nailed to the cross, did they place a loincloth on him? And I don't have a definite answer for that, but whatever it is, it's not pretty. It possibly means the crucifixion also constituted a sex offense. Because they felt, for whatever reason, they had to put a loincloth over his genitals to conceal them from view. The different things he lived and died for between all four Gospels, and you can look up, there's a Marilyn Manson painting and T-shirt featuring three amalgamated heads of Jesus, and to me they stand for the deception that's propagated in the later three Gospels in Matthew, Luke and John. The convoluting of his case, and how perfect that it works out to be that these later Gospels would have definitely been in ideological favor of making the ancient monarchy look just and good. That's what makes me think that maybe the scribes, the later scribes, were answering to someone connected to the monarchy in the Bronze Age, because the monarchy did not want to appear to the people to be unjust, cruel, or anti-Semitic and murderous. And so it's a bit like the whitewashing, you know, Pontius Pilate whitewashing. It's a bit like the monarch doing the same thing. But then, it interests me too that the scribes obviously turned to thinkers that would write in Greek, coin Greek thinkers. From my somewhat limited understanding of the history of Greek culture, sexuality was a lot more open in their culture, and there was definitely a lot more wisdom in their culture. There's the riddle of Epicurus, where God belief is rejected pretty much almost 2 millennia ago too. You know, is God willing to prevent evil but not able? Then he is impotent. Is he able? No, sorry, then he is malevolent. Is he able but not willing? No, hang on, I had it right around the first time. Is God willing to prevent evil but not able? Then he is impotent. Is he able to prevent evil but not willing? Then he is malevolent. Is he both able and willing? Then why do we still have evil? Is he neither able nor willing? Then why do we call him God? Now, these sorts of questions were being asked by ancient Greeks ages ago. And I think I can just imagine these scribes wanting to try to clarify the question of who Jesus of Nazareth was as best as they possibly could. So someone at some point turned to scribes to try and make this story official. And consequently, it winds up being written in coin Greek, even though Jesus of Nazareth was Jewish. And I just find that interesting. It's almost like that the text itself, even though coin Greek is now considered an extinct form of Greek language, it's just interesting in itself that Jewish people were turning to consult, at least in a translatory sense, the wisdom of the Greeks. So yeah, there's a song by Korn called Hypocrites, which addresses not so much the political system, but just the hypocrisy that comes out of religion. And he says, you know, your Messiah was never mine. And a lot of these artists are constantly criticized by the religious right to have shown a lot of disrespect for the humanity of Jesus of Nazareth. Out of all the people still calling themselves Christian, Bishop Spong is like one of the only bishops whose opinions I admire, though I would like to debate him too, only on a small handful of matters. He acknowledges evolution. He acknowledges rejecting the existence of the theistic God. So him and I agree on a lot of points, but there are still some points of contention I would have with his movement that I'd like to debate him about if given the chance. This has been 39 minutes, so I'll stop. So if a supernatural religious believer studies a trying to see if I can. How do I reverse the camera? There is not enough light for this.
G'day.
I'm just a humble DJ. I'd have no idea what it takes to get Capital Cameras famous.
Look at me, Frankenstein. We come from Penat Milato. Look at me, Frankenstein. We come from Penat Milato.
Watch Luke and you too.
Thank you, my friend. No worries. Yes, watch my YouTube channel, Luke Banton.
I've been inclined to call this app, I call it soda water rhubarb.
Luke, turn that off for a second.
Be back. I would also say in Roger Toll's case that typically what men do at his age once past, once over age, particularly in Roger's circumstances.
Julio Iglesias.
He's better than Julio Iglesias. Come here, Julio. Yeah. Look at you, sexy baby.
Tonight is approximately another anniversary for this right sinus nasal mucosa retention cyst. Happy anniversary. Again. Tonight is approximately another anniversary for this right sinus nasal mucosa retention cyst. Happy anniversary. Again.
They come back to me. Now every single mess for you to find. Hey! Hey.
Though of course completely straight, Roger Tall and Gary Cans will assure you that they are doing everything they can to be the two men in the nursing home who the nurse in her 30s will say that they're the two asses that she can't stand being told to wipe.
They have to have a talking hen going, who will help me? Who will help me bake the bread? Blah, blah, blah. So it goes on and continues in church where it's,
remove the title Jesus the Savior, remove the title Jesus the Martyr. Yet to these religious minds, the Freemason religious mind and the Christian religious mind, they're both what they would call supernatural, above and beyond beyond nature, but they both now that I've stand up and gone to the bus stop, I'm a little more alert. So, I'll go back to... So, I pretty much drew in this outline now of where... and now the bus is here. So, is it bus 50? Oh, sorry.
So, I think statements like artists... are criminals or artists are criminals and don't even know it traces back to, you know, the person's saying it would be, as in the case of Roger Tall and Gary Cans, they're Freemasons who will try to insist that they, to other people, that they joined a religion in order to become more moral.
Joe, check out these pigeons. Roger Redundant always wants to comment on it. The menus are all in French.
Basically, if they want to celebrate beliefs that are 2,000 years old, why don't they practice treatment therapies, methods that are 2,000 years old? And, you know, I think it leeches are too modern.
Capsules.
Yeah, that's why I think the name Capital Chemist maybe took off, because cap is in capsule, so. Anyway.
Music, yeah, makes me. I paid him $50 anyway.
So hard. It makes me say, oh my god.
Are you listening?
Yeah, man.
I said anyway, I paid him $50 anyway.
Oh my god.
Joe! Joe, come here, wait.
You'd like to leave Big Pharma? If you learn, in the future people will die from radio, but we'll say they die from cigarettes. To my mind, Roger and his researchers talk a lot like whores, but they're like going, oh, can we affix this conflict against your name? And they're always looking for the conflict because they haven't falsified their religious shit yet. So it's like whores on the street who are like, instead of saying, do you want to buy my titties and my cunt, they're going, can we say you have this? Can we say you have that? Can we say you have that? Can we say you have that? But it's whorish nonetheless.